Hi everyone, thanks for joining me. I'm Lewis Goldford, I'm a composer. Welcome to my little COVID cave here, just making do with the situation. I hope you all are okay and doing the same. I'm really happy to join you nonetheless for the Yerkam Forum. Wish I could have been there in person, obviously. But I'm happy to show you a couple of my pieces today, two recent pieces of mine that deal with techniques of automated orchestration as well as spatialization. The first of those pieces is Tell Me, How Is It That I Poisoned Your Soup for Large Ensemble and Electronics, premiered here in New York City by the Talia Ensemble in spring of 2019. The second piece is also from around the same time. It's Au-dessus du carrelage de givre. It's the piece that I wrote while in Paris during my cursus, and it was performed by Benjamin Atanas, the tenor. It includes original poetry by Katia Bouchueva, and original video montage by Larry Sapel and myself. So the first of these pieces, Tell Me How Is It That I Poisoned Your Soup, has this curious title, and its underlying foundational philosophies come from a theory of interpersonal communication by the American psychoanalyst Edgar Levinson, who sort of postulated that in order to enter the sort of inner reality of a patient, you need to sort of take on that inner reality. So the example he gives is you have a schizophrenic patient in the hospital who won't eat the soup being served to them and believes that you're the one who poisoned the soup. And how do you enter into a meaningful dialogue with that patient and convince them to eat and to stay healthy and stuff when they think that you're the one trying to kill them? And Levinson postulates that one has to sort of take on the premise that, okay, you did poison the soup in order to enter that person's reality. And in a way, sort of talk them out of it, talk them to safety. And these are methods that trained therapists use in clinical situations and elsewhere. And it's my belief that some of these sorts of ways of interpersonally relating are present in our music as well, in order to enter into the world of a composer and to hear what they hear. I think one has to be, in a sense, willing to take on the composer's sense of inner reality, that what they hear and what they're trying to put forth in a score is meaningful to them. And it's, you know, this is against the backdrop of everything that is challenging about our situation in new music.
So the source sounds that I used in this piece were all field recordings made in Taiwan, which was my home for 3 years. Those were all sounds of things like sort of environmental sounds of wind, rain, and typhoons especially. Those are common in the spring. The wildlife that's kind of unique to Taiwan, the indigenous frogs and birds. So in attempting to resurrect those sounds and bring them back to life, I had to sort of reconcile one approach to orchestration with another. The kind of very, very new and inspiring results that I would get from systems like the Orc Idea software, which would offer a lot of instrumental aggregates that I would never have imagined, but were very, very creative solutions nonetheless. And then I had to sort of make that work with my more traditional approach to orchestrating sound targets, which is mostly sitting with pen and paper and, of course, working with a maquette of a partial tracking analysis.
So the instrumentation here is bass, flute, doubling, piccolo, oboe, contrabass, clarinet, and bassoon. For brass, it's horn and trumpet. For percussion, it's vibraphone, bass drum, tuned gongs, bell plate, Chinese cymbal, crash cymbal, large wood block, large temple block, log drum, and Waldteufel, piano, violin, viola, cello, bass, and live processing and fixed media. There's an introductory section with expository material, sound sources that you don't hear, very abstract, followed by a section of material that's based on recordings of Taiwanese birds. Then that's followed by the sounds of howling wind on a lake, a slow developing section towards the middle here, that mostly consist of FM chords that are orchestrated. A lot of these are being done by hand. Most of these are done by hand. And then that is taken up by a physical model of a string feeding back on itself. That's orchestrated as well. another kind of environmental ambient section of Taiwanese recordings. In this case, it's frogs that are sort of unique to the island and forest type sounds that are orchestrated more or less meticulously. And then that is taken up by another section of abstract sounds. In this case, they're rather impulsive sounds. You can kind of see here the sort of segmentation of this section is really of concern. And that's followed by more wind sounds, especially the sound of shutters being blown around in an interior space. Since we don't have time to cover quite everything, I'd like to talk to you about orchestration in just a few of these sections. The first of which, I'll just zoom in here on the section of howling wind that follows the section of bird sounds here. So I'll just start at the end of the bird sounds here, and you can kind of hear what's going on, and I'll break it down for you. So here, let's listen for just a second. I began by hearing the pitched components of the howling in this wind sound, and for that reason I chose the Spectrum database. I've had better luck with the Spectrum database when targeting the pitched components of any of my sound sources, so for that reason I chose the Spectrum database in OrcIdea to start with. I also wanted to explore rapidly changing pitch structures, mostly at quiet dynamic levels, within this kind of global sound of the howling wind. So for that reason, I kind of gave it an onset time gate of about 100 milliseconds, a threshold of about 0.1, which we tend to think is good for voice and piano sources. It happened to be decent enough for wind as well. I targeted a number of playing modes in here that I believe are kind of evenly split between pitch and noise, flutter tongue and fluttered air sounds, for instance, things that are mostly based in the low tessitura of the bass flute, where some of those things can really come alive and I think blend well with the spectral centroid of the wind recording that I was working with. Various gradations of flautando, tremolo, sulpante, cello. However, in the interest of concentrating on the pitch components of the sound, and not so much technique and timbre, I decided to fold these string techniques down just simply into collegno tratto across the board. The strings are mostly just playing in one single play mode after the results had initially returned a greater variety of play modes. This worked for the pitch components of the wind, but I wanted a greater sort of correspondence between the source recording and the orchestral solution. So you do hear actual wind recordings being played back as part of the electronic cues in that section, but it's important to emphasize that these are not the original recordings. Instead, these are carefully crafted filterings of the original wind sound with the goal of avoiding a complete saturation of the spectrum at any one moment and allowing the instrumental solution to come through and not be masked by a lot of low noise that's present in the recording. I tend to orchestrate in layers, and I think the layer that really sort of glued everything together for me in this section is the layer of percussion sounds that I added sort of last. Gongs that are reduced to just four pitches, I had more in my solutions. Mostly soft rolls and small attacks with long decays. They seem to more or less mimic chimes being blown around in wind, and having that referent, I think, is really special for pulling together all the other pieces of the orchestration and kind of creating the sound object that I needed. In Au-dessus du carrelage de givre, orchestration plays a pretty crucial role as well. The piece is based on a dream of sorts, and so in this dream I sort of imagined myself at the center of a violent altercation that takes place in the south somewhere, in an old house on a warm summer night, in which I'm hearing the sounds of crickets and cicadas, which seem to define the space around me. The poet Katya Bushueva graciously developed really lovely texts around some of these sounds and images. And towards the beginning of the piece, you sort of hear some of these environmental sort of expository sounds unfold, including an orchestrated layer of cicada sounds made out of a recording. But in order to create a sense of disconnect from the literal feeling of that recording, I chose to orchestrate it with a series of high instruments. I could hear the use of high string harmonics to sort of imitate some of those phasing in and out of partials, but it wasn't working so well. I turned to OrcIdea, chose some onset parameters that were not actually as generous as the ones that were used that I showed you previously. But I was surprised by how well the system was able to maintain the character of the original recording. So this is what the layer sounds like by itself. And you hear this recur throughout the piece in different forms, different levels of transposition, etc. But one thing that I found interesting, I never would have guessed on my own that this particular aggregate combination,
in addition to using string harmonics simply because the register was quite high, I would not have thought to use accordion, not just the higher pitches of the accordion, but the shaking of the bellows of the accordion became kind of integral to the aggregate sound that I chose. The sounds of very delicately plucked components in the harp and the piano, those are things that I gradually settled upon as I ran more and more solutions and started to more specifically zero in on the parameters that gave me more pleasing results. Ultimately, it was the temporal shape of this phasing of the partials that OrcIdea was able to give to me that I wasn't quite able to sort of get at on my own and having done what I could by hand.
By itself, this is what the accordion part sounds like. And then the soprano saxophone. Glockenspiel. And altogether, if I put that all together in the layer once more, as an aggregate, it retains this character of an outdoor field of cicadas. These processes of orchestration unfold throughout the piece in other guises as well, especially in its interaction with the voice, since it is a vocal piece and there are a lot of vocal synthesis procedures at play as well. Timbral and sinusoidal morphing between different voices that are intoning the same text. Part of this, there's a sort of blurry line between orchestration and spatialization that I believe occurs about halfway through the piece. Here's an example.
Très lente. Et au milieu d'un paradis, l'âme programmait les vagues, l'été, l'âme.
There are ideas that started out purely as spatial ideas. For instance, here, the idea was to synthesize a cloud of phonemes and consonant sounds and to send them up a kind of swirling, tornadic, vortex-type structure. There are interesting sort of Doppler effects, timbral phenomenon, otherwise, that come out, and you don't experience such a quick event like that as purely a spatial event. What's being used there is a model of a vortex, or of a series of vortices. The idea here is to put everybody in the room at the center of this sort of cyclone. And this is just a small image of the Saint Catherine in which it was performed. We had a series of 17 speakers. The patch that I created for the piece addresses outputs for each of those speakers. So to create this sense of chaotic, turbulent motion that sends everything up, I used a couple of different sources to address the outputs through those speakers, one of which is the work of Dr. Lay Orff, who studies violent tornadoes in the United States, specifically the fluid-like stream tubes. I created a kind of analogy for this same kind of structure here by building a series of vortices that intersect and converge in open music, and these are used to define the trajectories for the sound sources, the phonemes themselves that are sent up the structure. So I use this in conjugation with the OM Prisma library to create ambisonic sound files that were then parsed within the Max patch in performance and sent to the various outputs. So the ambisonic sound files are just one form of spatialization in this piece. There's of course live processing and all the rest. A lot of spatialization in the piece is point source, individually opening up and closing the gates for individual outputs. So to handle all these different sound sources that need to be spaced, I assembled everything in the patch into a kind of score form here. This is a Bach roll object that you may be familiar with if you use the Bach library. So on this staff right here, you can see that all the point source spatialization is being handled as a series of note events that open up and close individual gates for individual outputs. So if I click on one and just bring up one of the Bach slots here, you can kind of see that what you have is not the use of one of the Bach library's individual SPAT slots, which is pre-formatted for the SPAT system, but instead this is just a matrix syntax that allows me to manipulate the matrix of the actual piece. So this is what the matrix for the patch actually looks like. There's kind of a complicated number of inputs and outputs that need to be managed. So having it all in a handy interface like the Bach note events allows me to really time everything precisely. If I were to just show you a little bit of how this interaction works, we're not going to hear anything, but if I just highlight a group of notes here and show you that there's a lot of fine tuning that can happen here with the individual inputs and outputs. And here it goes. So with this basic matrix syntax, it's very easy for me to concatenate individual point source events into larger phrase structures. It gives me control at the phrase level and allows me to really synchronize sound files and live synthesis events with the spatialization itself. Well, thank you all so much for watching. I hope this has been useful, and I really appreciate your time. I'm looking forward to watching the other presentations this week as well. It's an honor to be here once again. I hope you're all staying safe. Hope everybody's healthy. And I hope to see you in person at some point soon. Thank you so much for your time.